Hello everyone, my name is Feline Hermans from Leiden University and this is another lecture of the course Psychology of Programming. The topic of today's lecture is how the brain processes programming languages. Maybe you've never thought of that, but of course when you're reading programs in a certain programming language, your brain reacts to what it's seeing, and that exactly is the topic of today. The reason I got interested in this topic isn't that I necessarily was interested in understanding how people process programming language. The topic was actually came to my mind because I started to teach programming. Because I started to get interested in the question, how to teach programming, how to explain to children how programs work. And this happened because in the year 2013, so about 7 years ago, I came into contact with a group of kids in Rotterdam, where I lived at the time. They had a programming club with kids, 8, 9, 10 year olds, and they were looking for a teacher to teach those children programming. And then they came into contact with me and I was like, sure, I can teach a bunch of children programming, even though I didn't really know anything about teaching. I had no clue how to approach this, but I thought, well, I can do programming, so how hard can it be to teach programming? And what happened at that point in my brain is subconsciously, I started to think back what happened when I started to learn programming, which was when I was about 10 years old. I had this computer and there was no Google then, there was no YouTube, no internet in my home. The only thing I had was a book. This was the book, Basic Computer Games. And in the book, it wasn't even an explanation. It was just printed out computer basic code that you had to manually type into the computer. And through that process of copying code and trying to understand what was going on, I sort of taught myself programming. So notice in this story the absence of a teacher. No one was really teaching me programming. I was getting it from a book and teaching myself, basically. This leads to the fact that many people that are teaching, many people my age, so children of the 80s, start to mimic this experience if they start to teach children. This is certainly what I did. It's just, you know, let kids explore. You give them some books and they can figure it out just by themselves, just like I figured it out when I was a kid. This is a very common part of how people believe programming should be taught, or how people from their own memory remember that they learned themselves. This culture of exploratory teaching is also very present in books you can buy about programming for kids. This is what I did. I went to a bookshop and I bought all the books I could find about programming for kids. And there you see also this exploratory vibe of teaching. Here are a few snippets. So the snippets from the books will be in Dutch, but there's an English explanation translation beneath it. And I will also read the explanation aloud if it's not entirely visible. So here's the first one. The best part of programming is finding mistakes. That really says something about the culture of programming. That's the history of someone that has made a mistake and thought, oh, this is cool, a mistake, I can figure out now what's wrong and then I can fix it. But of course, this isn't necessarily true for everyone. And to call that the best part of programming, it's also interesting to note what they don't say. So they don't say the best part of programming is that you can create something that you really like an iPhone app that you want. They also don't say the best part of programming is it's a really good career choice, you could potentially make lots of money. So they really focus on the part of programming that you can do by yourself, figuring out what the mistake is and then fixing it. Programmers only learn from making mistakes. This is also the perspective of someone that has found a mistake and then saw that mistake as an opportunity for learning. But of course, there's lots of other things that could be the result of a mistake. Maybe you make a mistake and then you're like, I don't like programming. I have decided this is not for me. Here's another one. You will fail often and it will be frustrating. Clearly, this is true. I mean, learning something, you are gonna fail. And yes, it will be frustrating. This is true for everything that you learn. But to put that in a book that's meant for young children says something about the parts of programming that we think are really interesting. Never be afraid to mess around and experiment and break the rules. So in general, I think breaking the rules is pretty good life advice. I like breaking the rules. But in the context of programming, it's also sort of weird, especially because this book is not about the programming language Scratch, as you might think, for children. It is about the programming language Python. So in the same book, they say, break the rules, but also a colon goes there and a quotation mark goes there and rectangular brackets go there. Not the round ones or the triangle ones, no, the rectangular ones. Python, you probably know this, is so precise that if you put a space in the wrong place, Python will crash. So on the one hand side, break the rules, tinker and try it out for yourself. But on the other hand, of course, there are clear rules that you cannot break because then everything will be broken. And most importantly, it's fun. Again, this says something about the culture of programming, that the most important thing, again, isn't the opportunity to make a lot of money or to create something that you really value, that you really want to have. No, the most important thing is that you're having fun. That is programming for kids in a nutshell. It's really hard. Here are some arbitrary rules that you should follow, but also experiment and have fun. Programming for kids, everyone. And this is especially interesting if you compare that with how we teach other things. Imagine you are caring for a kid and they want to learn to play the guitar or they want to learn to play tennis. You wouldn't say, hey child, here's a tennis racket, here's a guitar. Just, you know, try it out, and failing is fun and break the rules, but also, of course, you have to play the right notes. If we teach other things that are typically taught outside of school, like music and sports, we very much think of joining a club and having a teacher that will explain stuff to you. But in the context of programming, this exploratory teaching is very, very common. This is maybe something that you've also encountered if you were part of a programming club when you were younger. This exploring form of teaching is very much what everyone thinks about. Recently, we did a survey. This is what last week's lecture was about, by our colleague Fenia Ivaloglu, where we had a survey about code clubs, how programming is taught, where we sampled 100 code clubs around the world. And we found that 71% of clubs let students, and these are children students, work independently. So they very much teach the same way I taught when I was teaching those kids. Here's some books, here's Scratch, here's Python. If you have a question, you know, I'm sitting in the back and I can always answer your questions. Don't be afraid to ask for help, but basically just try it out yourself. That's very much how people think, and that's very much how I was teaching at this point. So it was 2013, I didn't really know a lot about teaching at that point. Unsurprisingly, at that point surprising to me, but now looking back, unsurprisingly, children in the club found it really, really hard. They were struggling, and that also made me struggle. I remember saying stuff to children like, well, I explained this to you 1 week ago. Like, don't you remember? I explained stuff to children, and I sort of expected them to remember it a week later without any extra additional practice. And the things we did also were very much project focused. So kids were making a Pac-Man or a breakout game, or they were creating a story and animation. Their questions would always be the form of, hey teacher, how do I do this? How do I make the paddle move? How do I count the number of balls in the game? So we didn't really talk about concepts. We were always talking about solutions to problems they were having. And of course, the solution to moving a paddle might be the same solution as moving a cat. But we weren't talking about the concept of movement. We were talking about solving the specific problems. And of course, that didn't really stick because every situation was really different. And at that point, I also started to get some scientific curiosity. At this point, I thought, well, people must have researched this. Researchers must have looked into this. And one of the things I found was this paper, Skill Progression Demonstrated by Users in Scratch, where those two researchers had looked at what happens if children create an account in Scratch? Sort of what do they do next? And they followed users for a number of sessions, a number of weeks or a number of months. What they found is that there was a really, really high dropout. So many children create an account on Scratch and then they just don't come back after a few sessions, which could of course mean that just programming isn't for them, or maybe they moved on to JavaScript or Python. But at least it says something. But what they also found is that the skill level of the children sort of flattened. So initially they learn a bunch, and then after a while they just sort of flatline. They don't acquire new skills. And that was very much how I also experienced my lessons. Initially, of course, children figured out where buttons were in the user interface and they got something done. But then they flatlined. They didn't move on to the next level, in a sense. They didn't advance to more abstract computational concepts like loops and variables or functions. They sort of, you know, they were happy they were building stuff and it didn't really advance from there. And again, remember, I didn't know anything about teaching at that point. So I didn't really know how to advance. I could see children weren't learning, but that was it. I didn't know what to do about it. And now maybe you're surprised. Maybe you're like, but wait. Aren't you a professor? Isn't teaching literally your job? And wasn't teaching literally your job 7 years ago? Yes, but we have this system in the Netherlands and in most countries around the world where if you want to teach in elementary school, you go to school for 4 years. If you want to teach older kids in high school, you go to school for 5 years. But if you teach in a university, you don't really have to know a lot about teaching. If you want to teach kids in university, you just get a PhD in any topic, astrophysics or software engineering in my case, and just 12 afternoons of learning a little bit about Bloom's taxonomy. This is one educational theory that many people care about here for reasons I also don't know. So you just get a few afternoons of educational instruction and then you're good to teach. So technically my job was teaching, but I didn't really do a great job at that. And the interesting thing that is a difference between teaching 18-year-olds or 23-year-old master students and 8-year-olds is that if you students are confused, probably you think, oh, I'm confused, maybe I'm not that smart, and you just go home and you read the book. But an 8 or 9-year-old that's confused, they will tell you. So I had an 8-year-old in my club, and again, those kids voluntarily came on their free Saturday afternoon to learn programming. One of them picked up one of my books and thumped it on the table and said, I am never coming back to this stupid club. So like, ow, you know, ow, right in the feels. It really, really hurts. But it was also very valuable feedback, because if I didn't manage to keep an 8-year-old that comes voluntarily on Saturday, if I didn't manage to keep them excited, if I didn't manage to teach a small group, we had like a maximum of 10 kids, if I wasn't even able to teach in that setting, probably my university teaching at that point also wasn't all that amazing. And this was the point that I really, really got interested in. How do people even learn? How does information go like from your ear to your brain? How can it be that I've explained the same kid, this is where you click, this is how you do, many times, and still it doesn't stick? At this point, I really wanted to know, how does anyone learn anything? And again, I have a degree in software engineering. I had no idea of what to do. So the rest of this lecture, the biggest part of this lecture, will be me taking you through a few theories about how people learn in order for you to gain a better understanding of how people, again, this is the whole overarching goal of this specific lecture. The idea is that from these educational theories, you gain a better understanding of how do people process programming languages. So there's a lot about learning today, but I assure you, all the way in the end, this will all tie back into how to design a programming language. So I started to read about cognitive psychology, which is the part of psychology that looks at cognition, at understanding of people, how to process information. One of the first things that I learned about is a very famous psychologist from the last century called Jean Piaget. So this is the 1950s. And what Piaget described is a theory for how children advance in different stages. So he describes 4 different developmental stages through which children traverse, in a sense. So first, when children are very young, so between 0 and 2 in age, children are at the sensory motor stage. And this means, think of a small baby, that they sense things, they feel, and they move, they react to the things that they feel. Babies don't really have a conception. The way they get information in is through their senses, and the way they get information out, in a sense, is by movement, the sensory motor stage. The next stage, if children are a little bit older, is called the pre-operational stage. So in the pre-operational stage, children start to form hypotheses about the world. These aren't great hypotheses. They might say things like, oh, it is raining. The clouds must be sad. Clearly, that's not how rain works, but they are trying to find relationships. They see sadness creates water. I see water, sadness must be involved. They're starting to form theories about the world. The next stage, if children are between 7 and 11, is called the concrete operational stage. At this stage, children can reason, but they can only reason about things that are right in front of them. So they can say things like, hey, there's a glass. If I drop it, it will fall. They can look at a concrete instance of a glass and imagine what would happen if that glass falls. However, they can't really do formal, abstract reasoning yet. So they have a hard time saying stuff like, every glass or everything, every object that I will drop will always fall. That only happens in the formal operational stage if children are above the age of 11. This is, generally speaking, when children start to be able to do abstract logical reasoning. So they can reason about things without the things being in front of them. Here's an overview of all the stages. So sensory motor stage, 0 to 2, pre-operational, concrete operational, and formal operation. And even though this is a long time ago, this theory has been criticized. In general, people do agree that children do move to different stages and that they can more or less be described in these four forms. More recent research, though, for example, led by Andreas Dimitriou, says that yes, these stages definitely exist. However, they don't necessarily exist at those ages. So what Dimitriou says is that if you are doing something entirely new, like learning Chinese or learning a new programming language, then you will fall back to the lowest level. You'll fall back to showing sensory motor baby behavior because you lack any conception of what is going on. To just give you an idea of how that will feel, assuming you don't know Greek, if you know Greek, then this is less fun. But if you don't know Greek, and I would ask you, what would you reply to this? You got nothing, right? Assuming, again, that you don't know any Greek. And what you will probably do is you will latch on to things. So what you see here in the middle is a pie in the first letter of the second word. And this is probably something that's familiar to you because you know pi from math. And there's also theta and gamma. These are things you might know from math, from other courses. So you grab onto this. You observe in yourself maybe that your energy is very much focused on the pie because it's the thing you recognize and all the other ones are a bit weird. That is typical sensory motor behavior. You don't really, you're not focusing on the words because it's just so overwhelming. You focus on little things, like a little bit like a baby. You grab things that are familiar and then you resist to let them go. You prefer to look at the pie because you know it, and then looking at the other letters is less comfortable for you. So that's trying to give you a little bit of the sensation of how sensory motor behavior looks like. When I started to look into this, I learned about the work of Raymond Lister, an Australian computer scientist that had actually worked on these different levels in programming. So he wrote a paper called Toward a Developmental Epistemology of Computer Programming, in which he describes how educators, teachers of programming are struggling with children or students in their classes not learning. And this paper, like the title is, you know, it's a bit hard to find if you're looking for struggling. A better title would be Why Your Students Hate Your Stupid Programming Club. Because when I read this paper, I felt so seen. I was like, that guy Lister has written this paper only for me. Like, here's a few snippets from the paper. We provided what we consider to be helpful diagrams, but they did not significantly appear to improve their understanding. I was like, it me. This is what I did as well. When children were confused about how to use a variable, how to create a function, I grabbed some paper. I was like, look, you do this, and then you do this. I was just drawing the blocks. It's like, this is what you do. But as Lister said, it didn't significantly appear to improve their understanding. This was completely unexpected. Again, it's me. We thought that we were practically doing the question for them. And this paper, if you're interested in teaching and you want to go in that direction maybe for the subsequent homework assignments, then I would really recommend you to read this paper, because it really catches this sensation of people trying to explain programming, for example, by using helpful diagrams, and students continuously being confused and increasingly getting frustrated, because clearly also the teachers were getting frustrated. It's a really nice paper, especially maybe if you already have some teaching experience, maybe as a teaching assistant, you might also feel very seen and recognize many of those patterns. So now I had realized that these different levels existed also in programming, and that sometimes students in my programming class, also at the university, not just in the Saturday Club, were really showing sensory motor behavior. So they were creating a program and they were confused, and they were just, maybe you've also shown this behavior yourself, you know, just trying to change one thing. Oh, the value is one too high. Oh, I'll just subtract one. That's clearly sensory motor behavior. You focus on a really small thing and you keep pushing it and trying out stuff. You don't step back and you don't reason in the abstract. So I realized, yes, there are these different levels, and some of the kids in my class are at the lowest level. I can see that they exhibit sensory motor behavior, and Lister has a really few nice examples of how to diagnose where students are. So how to understand, is this child sensory motor programming or pre-operational programming? But still, Lister doesn't really say anything about how to get children up, how to make sure that they get to a higher level. So I had a vocabulary that was lovely, and I had an understanding of who is where, but I didn't know how to push children up. For that, I needed to read a little bit more. One of the things I learned about was a Dutch scientist, actually, called Adriaan de Groot, and this was in the 40s of the last century, and he was a mathematician. He was doing a PhD in math, but he was also an avid chess player. And sort of instead of working on his thesis, he got interested in doing research into chess. He wanted to understand, why are some people better chess players than others? Because clearly there's a difference in ability. Some people are good chess players. He was a pretty good chess player, but he wasn't a grandmaster. He wanted to understand, why are other people better than I am? That's what he was interested in. So he did two different experiments. In the first experiment, he showed people a chess setup, like the one you saw here. And then you have a novice, so a club player, and an expert chess player, like a master or a grandmaster. He showed this setup to them for a few seconds, and then he would cover the chessboard with a blanket, so you couldn't see the pieces anymore, but they were still there. And then he asked, can you reproduce the setup? So reproduce on the second chessboard as many pieces as you can. Question. Oh, I forgot to put in the panda, but we can do participation without a panda for this time. So you can think about this. Who do you think did better in this exercise? Would it be a novice, someone that just knows a little bit of chess, knows the rules and can play? Or would it be an expert? So think about it. In this case, actually, the experts did significantly better. So it was way easier for chess grandmasters or chess masters to put all the pieces as they were on the original board than for non-great players, for average players. But then he did a second experiment. And in the second experiment, rather than using a real chess setup, as the one you saw here, he used garbage chess boards. So this, what you're seeing here, I'm not a great chess player, but even I can see that this is random. Like there are two kings next to each other and there are pawns all the way on the other side of the field. So this can never happen. He repeated the setup otherwise exactly the same. So show it to both experts and novices for a few seconds, cover the board, and then see who does better. So again, think of who do you think would do better? Is that a great player or an average player? So the answer is they're both bad. So you can see the sad face of the novice, but there it is. They're both really sad. So there was no difference and everyone did way worse than in the previous setup. And why is this? The reason for this is that what an expert does is an expert, when remembering a real chess setup, they're not remembering pawn, pawn, rook, king, queen. What they're remembering is, oh, this is the Sicilian opening, and then three pawns are in different places. So they don't have to remember many things, they just have to remember a few things. Whereas a novice that lacks a good vocabulary of all the different chess setups, all the possibilities and openings, they do have to remember all of the separate things. So the thesis of Adriaan de Groot, you can still read it. It's called Het Denken van den Schaker. It is in Dutch because this is how he wrote PhD theses in that era. It's one of the founding works of cognitive psychology, which is interesting because, again, Adriaan de Groot was a mathematician and he accidentally sort of stumbled into this area and he founded this subfield of cognition and research into how people process thoughts. And the most important concepts from his thesis is called chunks. So the chunks are the things that I was just referring to. For example, Sicilian opening. That is a chunk. And he said when people remember things, they use chunks. They don't do all the individual pieces. They do a group of pieces together. And that helps because it's just easier to remember a lower number of things. So maybe this explanation already convinced you, but I think it's better if we really try to experience chunking. So we're going to do a little bit of an experiment, very much like Adriaan de Groot's experiments. I'm going to show you a sentence, so not a chess setup, but a sentence, just for half a second. So I'll show you a sentence and then it's gone again. And it's your job to remember what the sentence was. Very brief sentences, 3 words, 15 letters, and of course, I can't check, but it's supposed to be fun, so no cheating. Don't pause the video and copy the sentence, because then clearly it would be possible. The goal is for you to really experience the power of chunking. So here we go. Be ready. Don't blink. You might miss it. Here's the first sentence. Okay, so I'm going to assume that it was impossible for everyone. It's just, it's there and it's gone. But actually, your brain is able to do this. I'm going to make the sentence slightly easier, and then you might get closer to actually being able to do it. Here's the second sentence. That was still hard, probably, but at least you got something. I'm sure you remembered a few letters, maybe 4 or 5 letters should be doable. And now I'm going to show you the third sentence, equally long, equal number of words. And I'm sure this will be doable for everyone. There we go, third sentence. So that was doable. I think everyone really understood this. And that is because Cat Loves Cake is just 3 chunks. If you're remembering this, what you're not doing is, oh, half a circle. Oh, a circle with a squiggly. Oh, a Catholic cross. Oh, a long line. You wouldn't have time for this. You process everything at once, and then you just remember cat as a concept, and then loves as a concept, and then cake as a concept. And these are just 3 things. Very much like the expert chess players saw a setup, and they're like, oh, Sicilian. And they could just remember that as 1 chunk. So these things, these elements that you remember are called chunks. And that was a pioneering work of de Groot at that time, that people don't remember individual things. What they remember are chunks. So I guess this concrete example has also convinced you now really that indeed when you remember things, you do rely on chunks. George Miller was a researcher that came slightly after Adriaan de Groot, and he built up on the work of de Groot, and he said that your short-term memory can only hold between 5 and 9 items, and that very much built up on the earlier work, and this is also what you saw in remembering. So you can easily remember Cat Loves Cake because it's just 3 things. They fit in your brain. You can even have extra thoughts. So on top of remembering Cat Loves Cake, you can still think, ooh, cake, oh, I'm hungry. I want to have a little bit of cake. It still fits within the 5 to 9 elements. More recent research rounds, this isn't by Miller, but this is stuff from, I think, 10, 15 years ago, says it might be even lower. It might not be between 5 and 9 items. It might be between 2 and 6 items. It might be more limited than previously thought. But still, the 3 elements of Catalov's cake, they fit in your short-term memory at the same time. These chunks, 3, will easily fit. The opposite is also true. So there's something that is too many things in your brain at the same time. Imagine this is the first sentence, actually, if you were keeping an eye on things. If you're trying to remember this, if you really try this, you do circle with a stripe and a long line and a sigma reverse and a diamond, then you can almost physically feel a fullness here, right? Your brain gets like, oh, it hurts physically. That fullness is called cognitive load. So if your brain is really full, if you are overloading the capacity of your working memory, then you experience cognitive load. And the idea of cognitive load is coined by John Sweller, another Australian researcher that came up with this idea in the 80s. He invented something called cognitive load theory, the theory of the fact that your brain can be too full to really process something. So what is cognitive load? What Sweller says is that there are 3 different types of cognitive load. Your brain isn't just full, it is full with certain types of information. The first form of load is called intrinsic load. And intrinsic load is something that's just hard. So imagine this is an exercise. Sweller did lots of work on math education. You have a length that is 8 and a length that is 6, and now it's your job to calculate what is the length of the third part of the triangle. This is just hard. There's part of the problem that is intrinsically hard. You can't really make it easier. So you just need to know that you can do a squared plus b squared equals c squared to solve this problem. But there's also something called extraneous load. An extraneous load is load that you add to a problem that doesn't really add to the complexity of the problem. For example, this is an exercise, something like this you've probably seen in the past, but sometimes rather than having the numbers next to the edges, the numbers are somewhere else and you need to transfer the numbers to the right place. Sometimes they also add text like, consider these values for A and B. A is 8 and B is 6. And now it's your job to figure out where the numbers go. This isn't really part of the problem. You're just adding extra complexity, extra distraction. That is called extraneous load. And then there's a third type of load. The third type of load is germane load. And germane load is good load. That's the type of load we want. You need to have a little bit of room left in your brain to store things to long-term memory. They have to be in your short-term memory long enough so that they can be stored in long-term memory. For example, the Catalov's cake, it was in your brain for a while, and it's possible now that you have transferred it to long-term memory. That if they ask you in 3 years, what was the weird sentence of the professor in Leiden, you'll say, oh, it was something with cats and cake. Remember the other sentences, even the crazy one that I showed you a second time, hasn't really stuck in your long-term memory because your brain was full and there wasn't saving power left. So this is the load needed to save. Here's a concrete example of one of the papers of Sweller. And if you want to go in this direction for subsequent homework exercises, this might be a paper that you might be interested in reading. And this paper will also, the summary will give you an idea of how do you do this work? Because of course, we talked about research methods a lot. What are ways to do research? What Sweller did is an experiment. This will be also a topic of, actually next week's guest lecture will be about how to run these type of experiments. So what he did was there were 2 groups of kids and they were each solving a problem. The problem that they were solving, the both of them, was like this. So A is 7 minus 4A. What is A? It's like a typical high school algebra question where you have to solve a question for A. Now, what was the difference between the 2 groups? One group got a recipe. They really got something like this where the explanation was, well, if you have something that's of the form A equals B minus CA, what you can do is you can take the CA and move it to the other side of the equal sign, but then the minus turns into a plus. And what you could then do is, hey, that 1 plus c, you can put it between parentheses together, etc. And then they, both of them, solved the same question. So one group with the recipe and the other group without the recipe. And as you see, the recipe and the calculation, they're similar. So the recipe was a recipe for the things they were solving. The recipe group, let's call them that, they did better. But then this might not be all that surprising, right? Because, well, you gave them a recipe, so clearly they would do better. But they did way better. They did spectacularly better. They solved the exercises in 1/5 of the time. So 20% of the time of the second group. So they were way quicker. But the interesting thing is they also did better on different problems. And this is, of course, what people have against these type of educational measures. They say, well, if you explain children how to do a problem, then they can only do that problem. But this wasn't true. And that's the interesting thing about this finding. And what Sweller says that this shows is that because the problems were relatively easy, what children could remember from this were the steps of the recipe. So they had germane load left to remember, oh, hey, something on the other side of the equal sign, you can always move it. But then a minus turns into a plus or the other way around. Hey, you can divide both sides of the equal sign by the same thing. So they acquired a repository, so to say, of tricks you can use to attack a problem. And in a different problem, the trick of moving something to the other side of the equal sign or dividing both sides by the same constant, that's stuff that sort of always helps. These are things you can try. That's the reason, Sweller says, that these children also did better on different problems, because they had load left to memorize useful techniques that they could then apply to other problems. This is like the germane loads in their brain. The other group, this group, that just had the exercises without the recipes, were fully engaged in solving the problems. They managed to solve the problems, but they didn't have room left to store anything. So even they were engaging in problem solving time, they didn't really learn how to solve problems. In summary, what I took away from all of this reading about cognitive load theory is that teaching well, if I am a good teacher, that means that I am managing the cognitive load of my students, that I'm making sure that there's always intrinsic load, there's not too much extraneous load, and there's also a little bit of germane load. What I don't want is no germane load. And what I also wouldn't want is too low of an intrinsic and extraneous load. Because research has also shown that if children think or students think problems are too easy, they don't put enough effort in, and then also they're not learning. So my job as a teacher is to balance the right amount of load. In summary, what we've seen so far is we've seen children advance through different levels, and neo-Piagetians, so people that say, yes, the levels of Piaget exist, but different domains start at different levels. We've also seen chunking, so the ability of people to group related information into one unit that allows for a greater memory, in a sense. Of course, your memory cannot increase. It is just this limited amount of places. But if you group things, then together, they only take up one space. And we've seen cognitive load, that if too much is going on in your brain at the same time, you can't really process new information. And you might say, why is this relevant? And why is this relevant for programming education? Well, knowing about these things has certainly made my life richer and easier, because, again, it has given me a new vocabulary to consider confusion. Previously, I might have thought of students or people or colleagues, if they are confused, like, they don't know anything. They don't get it. Why doesn't this student understand? Why don't they know this? Whereas a better way of phrasing this is, hey, they're acting in a sensory motoric way. So if I'm teaching first year students Python and they keep like pushing the same line of code, pushing the same button, like removing a bracket, adding a bracket somewhere else, I can now think, oh, clearly they are lacking an abstract representation. They still don't know what they're doing, but I understand because I see they have no concept. Instead of thinking, hey, that person doesn't know anything, sometimes they also lack chunks. So sometimes in teaching or also in explaining something, you don't necessarily have to be a teacher, you're explaining something to someone, and you see this blank stare, it's not because they're stupid, they don't know stuff, it's because they lack chunks. Again, remember all the different elements. Sometimes you are speaking literally in a different language. People don't have the right chunks, so they don't understand you. And also, it's a nice way of looking at yourself. I think I've been kinder to myself about being confused. So instead of thinking, oh, I don't know anything. I mean, sometimes I'm learning a new programming language and I'm like, oh, I don't know what to do. I'm stressed. I'm stupid. But now I say to myself, I just have too much cognitive load. And maybe there's something I can do to self-manage my cognitive load. If I'm looking at a program in, I don't know, Kotlin, because I'm doing Kotlin, it might be too hard for me to read the code. Maybe I can translate it to Python first, then I can read it more easily, lowering the extraneous load, and then translate it back. So there are things you can do, like phrasing the problem in a different way, looking at it in a different way, using tools and techniques to lower your cognitive load, and then it turns out you're not actually stupid, you're fine, you just were looking at the problem in a form that was creating too much overload. Maybe you've heard, or maybe you will read this after this lecture because you got interested, that some people don't like cognitive load theory. There are lots of people on the internet, lots of researchers that say, yes, but cognitive load is not a good theory. Sweller keeps changing his mind about what ingredients are in the theory. So we just talked about the three different forms. In some papers, he talks about two forms and then about three and then about two again. Some people don't really like cognitive load theory. One of the reasons that people typically present against cognitive load theory is that they say, yeah, but it's not a predictive theory. It's very hard to measure cognitive loads, and it's very hard to predict how much cognitive load a student will have from an exercise. And here I would say that this is what we talked about in the lecture when we were talking about theories, is there are different forms of theories. And I don't interpret cognitive load theory as a theory that says, here's an exercise, here's a program, here's a problem. You can give it to children and then you could say this problem has 6.5 cognitive load that it will induce on people. Cognitive load is also very dependent on other things, on prior knowledge, for example. Imagine you would spend 20 years memorizing all the characters in my weird sentence. Clearly, you would do as good in remembering that as if it would be words in English. If you already know a lot, it gets easier. This is also clearly shown by Adriaan de Groot and his chess examples. So a problem doesn't have a cognitive load it induces. This really depends on the person that's processing it. There's also some research that shows that kids from poorer families, for example, typically always experience higher cognitive load because they might be worried about, will I have food tonight? And then a little bit of their cognitive load is already taken by worrying about food or about shelter. And the same might be true for you now in times of the COVID virus. Maybe you're worrying a little bit about the virus and about what will happen. And that fills up some space in your brain. So cognitive load for me isn't a predictive theory. So clearly it's hard to measure because it's more a theory, a lens through which you can look at things. So now let's take this to the context of programming, because we haven't talked about programming and programming languages for almost 45 minutes. So let's look at programming languages through the lens of cognitive load theory. For me, knowing about all these things really helps me to shape programming languages and helps me to shape my thinking on programming language. For example, this is a programming language called Quorum that's designed specifically for high school students. And if you look at this problem, at this program, repeat 4 times, print 0. What will this do? Well, it will repeat printing 0 for 4 times. You can count the chunks. You can say, well, repeat 4 times, assuming this is read by someone that knows English and that can see repeat as one thing. Clearly, if this was a 6-year-old, it would be R-E. But assuming that, you could say, well, repeat 4 times, 3 elements, print, open bracket, 0, closing bracket, 4 elements, 7 elements together. You can count the number of chunks. So you could say, 7. That is likely to fit in someone's working memory. Then you can go to Python. You can say, same problem, solving the same problem. This will also print the 0 4 times. How many elements does this have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. That is a lot. And then if you dive deeper into this, we will not cover that topic, but suppose you're interested. You could even look up a concept that's called element interactivity. So the more interaction there is between elements, the harder it is also to process. So that's also true here. Some things go together. If you have a bigger for loop, then some lines are part of the body and some lines aren't. So there's also some interactivity between the elements. And then we can also go, so this is someone that's being frustrated behind my video. We can also go to Java. Well, I'm not even counting, but this is clearly many, many, many different chunks. And again, this is how I use cognitive load theory. You can use it to compare different programming languages to each other. So I'm not saying, oh, Quorum has 17 and Java has 45, but even if you assume the fact that you can't really measure it, you can still use it. You can say, hey, I couldn't help but notice a for loop in Java has more elements than a for loop or a loop in Quorum. And in that sense, it's helpful. It's helpful to identify what are chunks. Looking at a problem, what are the chunks? A for loop, a condition, a function, we could call them chunks. And if you are proficient, fluent enough in the language, then probably reading a chunk, like reading a letter or a word, doesn't really take too much energy, doesn't really take up too much cognitive load. So for me, it's really helpful to have this vocabulary of, hey, different programming languages might have different chunks, and different parts of programming languages might have a different number of elements, and thus induce a different cognitive load on, let's say, a naive reader that hasn't acquired the entire chunk yet. The homework for this week is again to pick a programming language. And what you can do is you can stick with the same programming language that you've already analyzed for a while. But what you could also do is pick a fresh programming language. For me, it doesn't matter. I would still be happy if there was a big variety of programming languages. Please don't all pick Python. Would be nice. But it is entirely up to you. And what you're going to do is you're going to comment on chunks. So what in the language are chunks and how do the chunks look like? So what is a for statement? That's something that comes to mind because we just talked about. What is a function? How many elements does it take to create a function? And again here, consider the programming language plus the environment. So in some programming languages, Scratch, for example, creating a function also requires pushing the right buttons. These will also be chunks you have to, or elements that you have to have in your working memory, because you have to remember, oh, I have to click that and I have to drag this. So these are part of the chunk. And in some cases, the environment in which you program can also add to the cognitive load. Now, what I also want you to think about is what type of cognitive load does the programming language create? And here you will see interaction between cognitive load and cognitive dimensions. And I hated that both those techniques or both those theories start with cognitive because it's so confusing. But in this case, they can strengthen each other. And here I would like you to go a little bit deeper than syntax, because the examples, I'm realizing this now while I'm speaking, the examples that I gave were very syntax based. But of course, there are other things that could also induce cognitive load. Think, for example, of a language like Haskell. Haskell creates a certain cognitive load just for the fact that you have to think about types. You have to have in your working memory, what type is this thing and what type is the function I am putting it into. that is also a type of cognitive load. If you have a language that does a lot at runtime, like Python, then maybe you need to have, as a programmer in your brain, what is the type of these variables, because the environment doesn't tell you. Whereas if you're programming Java, you don't have to remember the type of a variable because you can just bring your cursor there and it will tell you, or you can see it before the variable name. It says int x. You don't have to remember it's an int because it will say so right there. So different programming languages, partly syntax, but also partly semantics and how they were designed, induce different cognitive loads. And some parts of that might have to do, for example, with cognitive dimensions like viscosity. If it's very hard to change something, then you might need to have a wrong version of the truth in your brain because you cannot change it easily. So there might be some overlap here with certain cognitive dimensions. So try to think of both syntax, cognitive load, and cognitive load that's related to concepts or the stuff you have in mind. And maybe also pure data, I think, was an example that we talked about in class, where also, I don't remember if I remember this correctly, you may correct me on the discussion board, where I think what you said is the order in which you drag things matters, but you can't really see it. You have to remember the order in which you created things. I think it was something along those lines. That is also definitely an example of a cognitive load that the programming language creates, that you it's your responsibility to remember this. Part of your brain will be full, so the part that you have left is smaller, and then you overload and you might forget about everything. So that is this week's homework. It's already open in the meantime on Blackboard, so do submit it. I'm really happy to see that even though we don't have live lectures, like 25 people are still submitting homework every week. So I'm happy you're all still there, you're happy, and you have some cognitive load left to focus on these lectures in the course. See you next week.